Don't start the meter yet. If you're keeping score, I'm number 13. I want to bring greetings from Saskatchewan, the only province I believe that has a town name archive. Everybody's about to Google it.
It's not a town, it's a rail siding.
It's a hamlet. I also want to give a shout out to Terry Cook. I'm really glad that Ian brought Terry's message to the summit today, and rock on, Terry. The history of Canada is under siege. So are citizens' fundamental rights to securing access to information and holding governments to account. Those words might seem alarmist, but there is nothing exaggerated about the critical archival challenges we now face. Let's start with the 1906 census as an example. For the first time in Canadian history, participants were asked to indicate, by checking a box, whether their responses in the short form could be made public after 92 years. If respondents said no, the form was not destroyed, but access to it in its name-specific format was forever prohibited. Canadians completing the census had never been asked this opt-in question before. In fact, until 1906, there was no informed consent clause. Rather, nominal census information had been made publicly available after a minimum 92-year waiting period without a single complaint to the Privacy Commissioner. So why is the consent clause in this particular example such a threat to history, rights, and accountability? Because slightly less than 50% of Canadians decided to keep their census information permanently inaccessible. The statistical integrity of the entire national census as a source of genealogical and historical information, of population trends and movements, and especially about everyday Canadians, has been forever compromised. Compare that to the hundreds of thousands of Canadians who think nothing of putting all kinds of personal information on Facebook and similar social media, readily available today and not after 92 years. It's also impossible today to know what might be historically important tomorrow. Can you imagine what records might not exist if parents of residential school students, Japanese-Canadian evacuees, or Chinese head taxpayees had first been required to give their consent before their government forms with personal information were transferred to Library and Archives Canada? The ability of those citizens and their descendants to right past wrongs and secure redress would have vanished, while Canadians in general would have an incomplete understanding of such events. The opt-in question is also a problem because it sets a terrible precedent, especially when the government shows little interest in collecting and preserving information these days. If census data today, what of other critically important case file data tomorrow? Immigration, health, Aboriginal affairs, employment, the environment. How can you avoid that these days? And hundreds of similar case-level documents of citizen-state interactions. Opt-in and voluntary completion do not produce the kind of results that are essential to informed public policy decisions. As the Globe and Mail recently argued in an editorial, the country needs more and not less significant and reliable information about Canadian lives and circumstances. Nor are things getting any better. Government departments and agencies may produce and collect a wealth of information, but there is no guarantee that these records are complete today or will be accessible in the future, especially the vast majority that exist in born digital format. And without proper digital management of these records, with content-rich metadata to make them searchable and understandable, and their ongoing preservation in accessible formats, these born digital records are going to be lost, or at best, incomplete, unintelligible, inaccessible, or inauthentic. In fact, recent reports suggest that some government departments do not even know the extent or location of all their electronic records. In other words, they have lost control over records that belong to the people of Canada. Notice I did not say the government of Canada. They belong to the people of Canada. That brings up the other big challenge in dealing with electronic records, namely deciding today what to keep tomorrow. Unlike analog records, which can sit for decades before being evaluated for possible archival retention, decisions about what digital records need to be kept and preserved must be made today because of the ephemeral nature of the records. Perhaps author Joseph Boyden unintentionally captured this situation in the closing lines of his novel, Orenda. Quote, "But hindsight is sometimes too easy, isn't it? What's happened in the past can't stay in the past. For the same reason, the future is always a breath away. The past and future are present." Archivists need to appraise the context of record creation and citizen-state interaction before records are created to ensure the extraction of those identified for long-term preservation. Finally, if the integrity of government electronic records is in doubt, then there can be no accountability. Canadians need open access to government records subject to specific restrictions, including passage of time, to protect privacy, to ensure transparency. That is how a democracy is supposed to work. Reliable records and access to those records, keeping in mind the Canadian balance between privacy and access, are at the heart of government accountability. So what needs to be done? We need to revisit the census opt-in question, as required by law after two censuses. Glenn, there's a new campaign for us. And see that it is removed, or at the very least, changed to an opt-out question. We need to revise and update the Access to Information and Privacy Acts to take into account the new record-keeping realities of the digital world. And we need a records management and archival and library infrastructure that can deal with both the challenges and opportunities of the digital world. It's already getting late in the game. And here I differ with Deborah. Time is not on our side. According to author Max Foran in the Literary Review of Canada in November 2013, he said, and I quote, "We are not staring out from the cliff edge of profound change, so much as watching the ground crumble beneath us, a collapse suitably heedless, remorseless, and fast." 2 decades ago, former National Archivist Jean-Pierre Wallot suggested that we are creating a new dark age, a reflection of at least a decade of similar warnings from the profession. Since then, we have lost critically valuable born digital documentary heritage. It is long past time to shine a bright light into that darkness, to build the necessary bridge of national infrastructures, to get off that crumbling bridge, and move with assurance from the age of analog to digital archives. And in doing so, ensuring that citizens and researchers have access to reliable and meaningful documentary heritage. The alternative is an ever-deepening dark age.